Well, episode 15, yes, episode 15, the new episode of all Beatles songs ranked, and I want to make clear, now we're at the upper echelon of Beatles songs. From now on, we're talking about classics. And number 38 is the last entry from Ringo Starr, Sir Ringo Starr, Yellow Submarine. It's often put down. I've seen videos in recent months, especially when people ranking albums, and many people, of course, rightfully so, think that Revolver is one of the best or their best Beatles album. But there were some videos when people are going like, "There's only one track I would skip on that album, and that's Yellow Submarine." And why skip Yellow Submarine? What's wrong with you? I mean, Revolver is a perfect album, and it's also perfect because it needs some lightweight that's fun like that. And you know, it's the sounds are it's not just a child it's a children's song, of course, but it's so much more. I think there's lots of sound experimentation, and it's a great Ringo song. And I think you can also hear Mick Jagger and Keith Richards, and probably some other people from Swinging London singing the chorus. I think it's even hard to say underrated, but I think nowadays it's kind of underrated. To me, it's a classic. And to me, it's the best song of the Beatles with Ringo as lead vocalist. Number 37 is also kind of Ringo as lead vocalist, but not really. It's the continuing story of Bungalow Bill. Of course, it's John Lennon on lead vocals, but the chorus, like with Carry That Weight, in the chorus they all sing together, and it's Ringo's voice that comes through the strongest. I think it's a great song, maybe one of the more overlooked great songs of the White Album. And you can even hear Yoko sing, and Not When He Looked So Fierce is Yoko on vocals. And it's a great story. Again, like with almost every song from the White Album, it was written, or the inspiration came in India, in Rishikesh, when they were at the Transcendental Meditation retreat, and there was a guy whose name apparently was Bill or William, and he was like, he always had his mother with him, and he was like a spoiled rich kid with a mother, and I guess he had a passion for hunting deer in like in Africa or something like that. And so John Lennon made fun of that in that song, and I think it's a funny song, but it's also like a social commentary song in a way. I think it's a great song. Number 36 is Things We Said Today. Again, more of those more overlooked gems. I mean, I think every Beatle fan likes or loves this song, but to put it on number 36, to me it's maybe higher than to some others. But I think to Bob Dylan it's also that high or higher, because it's probably the only Beatles song covered by Bob Dylan, at least on a kind of official record. He did it for Paul McCartney tribute album or something, where like that, where famous artists are covering Paul McCartney songs a few years ago, and he covered Things We Said Today. So Bob and me, we agree on that. Number 35 is Something from Abbey Road. George Harrison, often described as one of the best love songs of all time, like by Frank Sinatra. I think Frank Sinatra called it the best love song and the best Lennon-McCartney song, but it wasn't a Lennon-McCartney song, so that was his fault. Yeah, it's a great, great, great song. Inspired, maybe a bit, it's nicked, that's George, maybe nicked at least the inspiration to the first for the first line in the lyrics from a James Taylor song that also starts with the line "Something in the Way," but that's just a little complaint. The melody and everything else is is 100% George, as far as I can tell. 34 is also, in my opinion, one of the best love songs, maybe one of the 20 best pop love songs of all time, and I love her. Great song from A Hard Day's Night, also a great scene in the movie, in my opinion. I think it's very cool scene. Yeah, and I love her. 33 is the title song from A Hard Day's Night. A Hard Day's Night. great up-tempo Beatlemania, high energy song. Yeah, it's one of the best from those early 63, 64 period kind of songs, and it's a classic. 32 is a song that wasn't a classic, but I think now it has redeemed itself as a classic. It's Hey Bulldog from the, again, Yellow Submarine soundtrack. I think 20 years ago or 30 years ago, it was very overlooked because the Yellow Submarine soundtrack was overlooked because it, let's face it, the Yellow Submarine album isn't even an album, and if we count it as an album, it's the worst Beatles album, of course. There's just four or five new songs, the rest is orchestration by George Martin. But so it tended to be very overlooked, like It's All Too Much, which is also a great song. We've had it like one episode ago. Hey Bulldog is the best of those four or five, I think it's four, new songs from the Yellow Submarine soundtrack. And nowadays, I think it's considered a classic. It's one of those. It's like with the Ram album by Paul McCartney. No one liked it 30 years ago, but now everybody thinks it's one of the best songs, and it is one of the best songs. Especially the instrumentation, the arrangement, bass line, piano, guitar, drums, those kind of things are almost perfect in that song. It's like a perfect showcase for what the Beatles as musicians can do in 2 minutes. Next one is 31, I Want You, She's So Heavy. One of the greatest songs of the Abbey Road album to me. I'm not sure if there's, maybe there are one or two still missing from Abbey Road, but this is in my top three Abbey Road songs. It was recorded a bit before the most of the Abbey Road songs were recorded. It was like in a transition period between the Get Back sessions and the Abbey Road sessions. So it wasn't really in the Abbey Road sessions. It was, I think, in February or March 69, they recorded it with Billy Preston on organ. I really hate, maybe hate is too much, but I really dislike the 50th anniversary Abbey Road edition. I don't need a remix of any Beatle album. I think they were good the way they were mixed in the first place. I think it's just a money grab, basically. And I don't like those mixes. But still, on the 50th anniversary box set of Abbey Road, I really like that box set and the money spent on it for one reason, and that's the alternate take of I Want You, She's So Heavy that's on there, which is even better maybe than the released version. It's a great, even more heavier version with Billy Preston really going wild on organ. And I think, yeah, at the beginning, it's like a live cut, all Beatles plus Billy Preston live in the Trident Studios, not at Abbey Road. The Trident Studios are in the middle of London, so it's in a area where people are living, and this song, of course, is so loud. It's one of the loudest Beatles songs, and you can hear at the beginning of the take on that anniversary edition, George Martin talking to the Beatles. We have to make it a bit more quiet, or that we have complaints from people who are living there, and I think John says something like, "Give us one more try, with full loudness." So it's funny that multi-millionaire superstar Beatles, they couldn't play as loud as they wanted. They had to think of the neighbors, that the neighbors don't complain. But you know, they did it, that take, and it's one of the best outtakes of the Beatles, I think. And also the finished version is one of the 31 best Beatles songs in my opinion. Number 30 is a classic. From now on, I think almost every song is a classic, but this is really a classic classic. The Long and Winding Road, from Let It Be album, from the Let It Be album. This is one of the few instances where I disagree with Paul McCartney's assessment, because he hated the version that got released. He hated the Phil Spector version, but I really prefer the Phil Spector version to the Let It Be Naked version that came out later when Paul revised the album and got rid of all the Phil Spector production. I'm a fan of the Phil Spector production. And you know, I think deep in his heart, Paul McCartney also likes or kind of likes the Spector production, because any time he plays it live for the past 50 years, he always plays that arrangement, and he always plays with either with strings or with strings on synthesizers. So, you know, if he didn't like the Spector spin on it, why does he play it live that way? I think he hated the Spector version because it was in this tumultuous time, and it was like the other three versus Paul, and Phil Spector was on Alan Klein's side and on John and George's side, so it was more like a he's the enemy kind of thing. But strictly musically speaking, I think the Spector version is brilliant. And Paul McCartney, one thing about The Long Winding Road that I think is interesting is he initially didn't write it for the Beatles. Big classic, but he didn't write it. He wrote it for Tom Jones. He wrote it for Tom Jones. I think I forgot why Tom Jones declined it, but you know, what a mistake by Tom Jones. It would have been maybe the biggest Tom Jones hit of all time. And you know, I can really imagine his voice on that song. He never, even after that, he could have made a version of it. I don't understand why. Didn't he like the song? It would have sounded perfect with. I'm not the biggest fan of Tom Jones, but this song would have sounded perfect with Tom Jones' voice. So that was number 30, and the 29 best Beatles songs. Well, you have to wait for the next episode. Thank you very much.